Well, but everything that Linda said is that everyone can look at the survey. And you realize you're not gonna.
So let's do, we got three.
They're much flyers.
And then what you'll see under the administrative director text, which is column three, that's what the, that's actually what we need, the definition of what the goal is back in the policy.
Our goal is to say, okay, well, this is tied to one of those values.
Equity, everybody sees those two bullets. So let's give ourselves like 5 minutes to talk through how the stable feeder pattern leads into equity process.
The one thing that was coming out
is that is not
consistent.
This one was actually done.
I'm asking logistically.
I don't know. I think it's going to have that more.
that for now.
It was interesting. Nobody seems to care until they make more money on buses and then have money left for cash.
So would we add, I don't know, language, haven't you thought about making that concrete, going to administrative director when decided? So it's a value right now. We can put that language in the policy itself. So it looks something like when the district is determining which.
It kind of gives the impression that you got what you got.
Which they feed each other.
We wanted to get our kids tough to.
So we have feeder schools and feeders.
So when a district decides to feed these schools, you have to have the same
question.
We need to make sure our facilities match what we think is required for our kids rather than saying, well, it's terrible for our kids, but we've only got a small building, so we're just going to live with it. Physical support,
and that's the right there.
So can we, because we've only got 7 minutes left, can we just raise a couple of questions? So one of them is the developmental stages and where does the biggest difference happen?
We have 7 somewhere.
Right. But the other question is the logistical possibilities. That's a question to me for facilities. Right? Is there, can we limit it to one?
Okay. So here's the questions I have on this. I think we should probably just get to the other.
Yeah.
So I think this is an interesting proposition. A 1-to-1.
So they're in the session
here. A 1-to-1 correspondence may not be able to be a success, however, that may be a balance to deliver on access and quality. Developmental question about when this ends.
Yes, because that was programmatic.
But I think underlying we hold good about something the discussion
of a state or I was going to say that the overall value to agree in.
Five minutes till we switch. 5 minutes.
What about this? What about that?
Sasha's point is that exams could lead to, okay, let's bust a bunch of kids to the whatever side.
And the way it's written out.
Yeah, but.
So here we have a process.
So the, are you the school board set?
No, I'm just not sitting there.
Minimize transportation.
Oh, okay.
Minimize.
So this group is away from schools. This is part of the residency certificate.
Are these all relative persons of bias, which are the bias?
So I do that. And the, I'm trying to think.
That last one.
Let's switch. So you've got two blocks under your turn in time.
Are there activities?
So well, I have a question.
So assignment building is here for the district is going to be focus options when it's here for the parents.
Okay, and I question that. Why is the district
If I was close to a computer that I rooms on, I might be able to see it, I might not. There isn't a place where I kind of close to.
Got it. Okay, yeah.
I'm sure but there aren't very many rooms that have so we could take a walk to get our
Well, I think there's a movement by our lockers to like this Well, and that's a lineup with the students is basically there was 24% non-title. Kind of put out something like it was only the cluster was one that was a third of
normal
room and I do think that we can
it's our first point
the last
Stop the fun here, stand up, and take the fun to the next table.
I'm a big believer in proximity.
So do we leave these here?
There's a great amount of time.
That's all the fun here. Stand up, take the fun to the next table.
And some of you know, some of you want to leave them behind.
Yeah.
Can you write something about?
I don't think so. I think we're going to finish at our last meeting. Yes. We take an interview with you unless you want what you say attributed to somebody else.
I don't know. You're smart. Can I help anyone?
Welcome to the other
what
side.
What if this is an
oh, wait, we
go to table
there.
Three.
Yeah. Oh, we're going there? Sit around. Grand progress.
Come and meet Joe.
We're coming. We're going.
Somebody else can Joe? We'd like you to meet the next
one. Hi, Joe.
We're chatting. We couldn't stop.
Strangers. Hi, Joe.
Oh,
you know what? You have more than six rubber hands.
So do we get your honor?
Okay, so you guys, what we have on this one is three in the back. Behavior patterns.
All right.
It's a triangle. Keep them consistent. K-5. Not even middle school, but student demographic for like, there are two statements about we should be shooting more in terms of contact boundaries. The policy suggests a benefit by having
Let's
go through exhibit one.
So this is how we incorporate in the family.
Well, I thought when I read this, I thought it was interesting that
which is the modern
The policy is like the big statement.
So regular and elementary kids go grand. Regular kids go to
So,
there's
definitely
like,
that's what I'm saying.
Because we still have that value system that grants that are history.
Okay, so
allow people to continue up the place.
Right, I think
Right, because it really does become the school to have.
Should we do more moving money for more kids? And I would come down. For me. And I think he was more really serious about that.
The real reason why it's not on the table is that stay together has been
a great question. Exactly. This is why we make that decision.
Diversity body demographics. And this is a criteria for which we're going to look at. What means so for our purposes, I think the way that's the second one is considered a different version of I feel like that's a phrase that's loaded.
Say about the next one in terms of the language.
So hang on, which is
So this actually holds up and you tell us that that
would be consistent with our application.
More
Does it link them to have a really strong program? because they're
like
students.
So here's a good context.
Yeah.
This is an immigrant school.
Yeah, so then it's all the
programs. What Maxine just described makes sense to me, too. Student body's got the full range. And we're drawing boundaries. How are we doing that? No.
That came up to me a couple weeks ago.
Boundaries of
geography. Is there a time?
We overlaid this with like,
one thought is, you know, there is
facilities within the drive. So in the short term, because of that, we can use them more frequently. Right? So some of the pieces, when we talk about all the awkward use of this, providing facilities.
What I wanted to say about stable programs is that that particular item does not, it's not a value on the values we've been working on, but it is a value on our, not even a value, but we're trying to be
focused on
the whole district, and that says in surrounding schools. And I think we should phrase selenium policy to be a whole district and not a school. So I just think that in surrounding schools, kind of is no longer really relevant. That's kind of like what we're doing the boundary around this school, as opposed to,
I'm curious of what that means in our geographic background, because again, schools are unfortunately geographic. So even other things, so to me, a school like
that was where is the other boundary? Right? So we don't, right. I mean,
Why, 5% minority,
That's what I was asking that question, is making sure that we don't have a school that has,
I don't know, where we
my high school in Southern Oregon, oh, or we have
Three more minutes and five safe routes to school.
You have till
7:10. You have till 7:10. In 3 minutes, I'll give you a 5 minute warning. Sorry.
The ability to walk or bike to school safely is like 2%.
When do we decide?
That being the most important.
But when we get to doing the priorities, hey, so what about promote a sense of community neighborhood?
But I think it's more so how to make sure that
that's a factor that
the neighborhoods like
so that's
the it's going through another minute pulling these neighborhoods
to avoid causing students who have continued to reside in a particular geographic area.
The programmatic I'd like to see where that's going.
Immersion needs policy.
I would say that some of the process that we just spoke about in D-BRAC is much better reaching out to students.
But if we don't, I get that.
So does the last
poll. Isn't that part of it?
I think that gets a little bit out of the way.
Yeah, neighborhoods, well, I mean,
yeah, it's good for
access. More than everybody here, because the worst thing is, like, you're in a K-5.
Well, access helps here.
Well, no, access here.
Yeah, I think, well, I think this is one of these tough questions. Really wanted to. One, on one end of the spectrum, we could bus kids all the way down, and every school could kind of have this right, and we saw these, you know, but you trade that off of having kind of ability to walk to school, not having, you know, 5,000 families driving cars or buses back and forth all the way down. I think what neighborhood means wherever we set the boundary.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but it's proximity. Where you live is proximity.
That's the way I actually say it.
So,
it's
so
the thought on kids will not be on a bus.
Is hate frequency out?
No, I get that, but when you say neighborhood,
I guess maybe we should look at the survey results again, but my sense from that
focus is again, but this is another thing.
The families in the like the families that, like, I think that, like, Riggler is a good example. That's a good question. Do you put just a question mark? I mean, what do we mean by that?
I don't know.
Riggler yeah, we should look at the phone box. If you look at the closing of Whitaker, yeah. Students that were in middle school, that went to Whitaker, then they went to three different schools. And every year they were in a different geographic location for 3 years, and then two more in high school. So it was, I mean, it was 5 years in a row.
Yeah.
So there's some students that there's some pieces about, you know, how that plays out.
How could it have played out to me? You could have been grandfathered.
Well, I mean,
I think there's an equity piece. I mean, I think about my regular family that one of the hardships we run into is we have a lot of kids who love more about what they have to do in reality.
Part of it was the closing of Whitaker, just hearing the cascading. There was a transition from major programs. They weren't necessarily boundary. It was not just a boundary.
Give an example of that. What's that saying? But the objective is surely equity and access.
When you have any condition that needs enrollment, to
see that's the
why am I the best one that can see every class enrollment without having to do multiple things over the course of
the year?
Because if you do transfers,
so maybe it's something like long term.
That's
where
it goes.
Congratulations, you're 2/3 the way through the exercise.
And you guys, welcome to the other side.
Is there going to be a chair there?
What?
Hey, Mom.
I've been working through it. I haven't even eaten my dinner. This is like the fourth D-BRAC in my life.
That's the best she's ever had. Good luck with your last group, guys. Enjoy your best stuff. Nobody's done that yet.
Okay,
so
here we go.
Going to gravy.
This is yes.
The best.
And tilt for River.
No pressure.
No, not yet. That's what I need. That's what I'm saying. No wheels around the table. I kind of love this. This way I just work with your mind. And I know I love your mind. This is a lot of information, so I'm just going to try to get through your second of where you are
buying. More than two middle schools.
So which one more
strong guns table in
K-8 or middle school?
An elimination of the number of
this is guidelines for student assignment.
Optimal use of existing facilities.
This segment is elimination of data that we intend to analyze. So there's comments about
focus options. It also is the number one value.
We've identified as a desire, potential desire.
Right. So actually,
also,
the first bullet of those.
So this just says, can I analyze much of us? And one of the
its ability to work, right? It's meeting our assets.
We will send out an email.
I had a huge problem with that one because my question is, I believe that at one point, whenever Jefferson talks, I mean, it's different bodies.
And they don't care about the letters.
And to me, I view that as, are we using proximity? Are we using a good lens, and not just racial equity, but in general, to decide or to make sure that there's adequate enrollment? Or are we talking in the, because up until now, there's been a lot of issues. Marshall, Ashley, Jefferson, Madison, you know, all of that. So I want to make sure that we're not just pushing kids to be able to go to the is the way that I feel. I'm going to keep it personal. So my particular little section of my
meeting, I think it's very important.
Was supposed to go to Meek. Meek closed.
I think it's okay.
So we went to Vernon. Vernon is at about
And so I feel like what's been done is whatever school that they grabbed from, they did. Even though by proximity, I don't think it makes much sense.
If you were at a school,
I think it would have, and this was an open enclosure, but it potentially, I felt like being used as a perfect or happy school. I think it's a great school. The Jefferson decision that our other choice was Madison, it felt like we were used as infilligent because
you're
in
a lot of things that happen just
in the body.
Yeah,
and I just feel like sometimes we're just so set on the numbers versus what makes sense. Who are we talking about? You know, because we're talking about half of Vernon's population. Historically underrepresented. And so I just want to make sure that we're really being thoughtful about
that. So
it's not that you have a student.
We fast forward, which I think that hits the west side of Beaumont. Last year, we went down to policy section 3, which was limiting the impact of boundary changes to the smallest number of students possible. So when we looked at the pieces under that, one of the big points that came out was in order to align with the value of land long term, having strong there's bullet point 2 here on the UDD that says avoid causing students who continue to reside in a geographic area affected by your more than one out of the school level.
So in a weird
the last group says both says that should not just apply to boundary change, it's for any enrollment change whatsoever.
Pretty weird.
If
we went by proximity of the grant.
If your goal is to have a real healthy enrollment on
the as with the Lincoln
Post. So proximity is now below.
Use the one that gets you to the don't do change year after year after year.
Yeah, and we talked about that with Marshall eventually. I mean, that needs to be looked at.
So you, that's kept.
That's been captured. That was the first group we looked at. So your point, I think, is
down. So I'm not sure that's a bad issue. That's a proximity issue. That exists, right? That's a program issue.
So,
but where does the program
it may indirectly
and the size of the program.
The other one
is it's a special thing for policy. I mean, it's not at all.
But I think locations, here's an example is.
So we're saying in order to have healthy programs, right. But I think indirectly we may be saying keep that healthy number up and find a way to keep it sustainable. I don't know if we necessarily call it out as a value or tell you a value in an outcome that says not because we're just talking about trying it's long term when D-BRAC and the moment transmitting video are supposed to be but long term the district has got to have a policy that says based on like 6 or 7 other what is your room to say based on the condition
add something to our value. So I'm just going to say that because it's missing, rather than say it's indirect, if we believe it, let's call it out.
I think what say something is whatever you do, make sure to
say that. We can assign you somewhere. So I think that you have to get something that you're interested in.
Or undeserved.
No, but I know.
That was important and it was
and so that
it's actually like a point to
ensure that as you are managing and rolling that design, you
and there
were
some other
areas also. Not so much policy, but we got to call it out somewhere.
And so I mean, I should wait that. That's kind of my programmatic, especially emerging, since our leaders are growing. I
No, because I don't know if that's going to be the D-BRAC enrollment together. I don't know if that would be some other, citizen. I don't know if it's simply making sure that whatever populations and impacts that they get a say before decisions made, do we have a say? I don't know.
No. No, I see
it
as
Meets the guidelines, meets the D-BRAC guidelines, whatever we
That's what I was trying to say at the last meeting. We're defining the No, I think that's my concern. The process is we are defining the group of children that go to school together.
Sense of community is important. Sense of community is important.
Well, that's fine. No. So other comments on
there's a cemetery. You can't even a Cully is separated from Beaumont Wilshire by a big cemetery. Obviously you can.
Now after a huge
You could have something that says you shall not have to walk.
One minute.
But I think if we get to like.
And it's so different, like in, you know, Central, Northeast,
But the problem is, three people don't finish at the same time. So congratulations, D-BRAC.
Thank you for all your hard work.
Congratulations. You just finished your exercise. All organizations on time. Congratulations. That means you're wrapping up.
Folks can stay where
we are.
Yes. So you can stay where you are right now.
Turn the chairs this way, please.
And a little bit of a special announcement. So we're going to transition to a report out now. Give your facilitators a second to breathe. And actually, Jason has a little special announcement.
So again, I just wanted to acknowledge that of many things that Max has officially graduated from Portland Public School. Things. One is circulating around is a card signed on behalf of all the D-BRAC members congratulating you and moving forward. And for the committee members, if you haven't seen, there are two boxes of what look to be really awesome chocolate cupcakes in the back to celebrate you graduating. So,
hooray!
Yay. Thank you.
Factor already.
Oh, wow.
This
it's okay. Mine has a little graduation. I appreciate all the speeches you guys are trying to be.
Okay.
I appreciate the sneakiness.
Did you catch us?
Yeah.
Okay, don't be caught up in this.
As an 18-year-old now, he noticed the cupcake.
Yeah, he was like, well, I'll just have a cupcake. And I was like, cupcake? What cupcake? He's like, over there, those cupcakes.
There's more here. If you denied the first time, yourself.
No, she didn't. I would have noticed that. I have one already.
What we're going to do here, and I'm letting Joe and Pamela and Jason hurriedly assemble their thoughts for a moment.
Ready?
Yes, let me tell the group. So we're going to spend about 5 minutes with a report out from the three subcommittee folks at the three tables. Then we'll transition to a large group discussion. Joe, take it away.
So this table, the best table, had three groups of factors to consider that are from current policy. Stable feeder pattern, and that's students staying together. Diverse student body demographics, matching the diversity of the district. And compact boundaries, which had a number of subtopics. On stable feeder pattern, it was noted that that was the number one priority that came out of the survey. So what's that tell us? And we all need to go back and look at it. There was a general consensus across all three of my groups that continuity amongst the cohort, you know, the group of kids matters. And there was most bedevilment around the second bullet, which is what do you do with split feeder situations where two come together and they go back apart? Is that a good thing or a bad thing? We had plenty of debates and also plenty of sort of conclusions based on Beaumont experience that the kids don't care. So and then the other point was some of this is so anecdotal for us we may be making it up, so it's hard to judge that one. The diverse student body demographics, there was some confusion. It ranked pretty high on the survey, but we're not sure what people were really responding to. And so there's some confusion about how it's written, and nobody was 100% sure of what different learning needs of the student body means. And then on compact boundaries, the one that seemed to rise to the top was sense of community, but we also see that as sort of there's a conflict between promoting a sense of community and talking about neighborhoods and really proximity and focusing on that. And we think proximity typically wins.
Jason.
Thank you, Jim. So
can you hold on 1 second?
Oh,
yeah.
Can you just repeat the last thing that you said about compact boundaries, please?
In the choice between keeping neighborhoods together and keeping students in proximity to a school that's in nearby them, the second one wins. We're not really sure about what neighborhood means, and we think sense of community is important, but sense of community when you're drawing boundaries is proximity.
Okay, thank you.
Jason.
All right, Judy, you ready?
Sure.
All right, so I had the other three factors, which were optimal use of existing facilities, program and enrollment stability in the surrounding schools, and third is limiting the impact of boundary changes to the smallest number of students possible. And so I guess generally what was the big takeaway was that there was not a lot of discussion in terms of changing the actual policy language, but much more what are the administrative directives that actually put those policies into action. So for me, that was a really surprising thing. It was much, much more focused on the execution of it. So first on the optimal use of facilities, a couple of things was, in order for the AD to actually align with our values on equity, access, and environment, that there was a good suggestion of moving the second section of that says, ensuring that projected student enrollment supports an adequate academic curriculum. I think there were some language changes around, you know, adding in addition to adequate, but equitable and effective to that, and moving that as the top bullet point of what it means for optimal use of existing facilities. Those were the structural things to make that part of the AD in alignment. Longer term thinking, there were a couple things that one that should be on the committee's radar and at future work, which was how does the use of optimal, you know, facilities interplay with the district's 20-year bond campaign to update the high schools and renovate and rebuild the elementary and middle schools. So how are you designing future facilities to really accommodate the needs of the students now and the programmatic needs long-term? And additionally, kind of calling out specifically the issue around Lincoln that even if it is at 1,600 students, that it doesn't have a cafeteria, calling out the fact that for a large part, Lincoln parents are comfortable with the overcrowding because those parents wanted their kids to go to Lincoln in the first place. So acknowledging overcrowding in some communities is okay depending on what school you're in, if it's a quality school or not. So part two, which is the program and enrollment stability in the surrounding schools. There was some language around changing it to not just the surrounding schools, but if we're gonna do it, be a district-wide focus, that it should be stable program enrollment in consideration of all schools in the system. And one of the big things that came out of this discussion was really acknowledging that boundary change is one of the multiple levers to address enrollment balancing in a different schools. And there was acknowledgement that number of clusters, like just generally Jefferson and others, went through a lot of changes over short periods of time. So within the 80, there needed to be language around really establishing a beyond just D-BRAC's work, establishing a framework of given an enrollment condition,
How does the district determine which is the appropriate lever to use with to address over or under enrollment issues, and at the same time, really finding the tool that is the most appropriate to balance enrollment, and also within that, to ensure that what has happened in cases like in the Jefferson and the Madison clusters, that you don't have school communities that experience multiple changes, not just boundaries. So there needs to be a framework in place that allows that mitigates to the best extent possible, having communities go through three different changes in the course of a couple of years. So not beyond just boundary, but that was an important factor that the group raised. And then lastly, around limiting the impact of boundary changes to the smallest number of students possible. Generally, there was good agreement around bullet points 2 and 3, which is avoid causing students who have continued to reside in a particular geographic area to be affected by a boundary change more than once at a particular school level. That was one that was really, I think, had a strong consensus. And also avoid separating small numbers of students from their classmates when they move to school at the next level. Yes, but the bigger question is when you're doing all of these evaluations, the question is, who is actually responsible for making the decisions and actually enforcing them district-wide so that everyone can see that whatever recommendation was going to happen actually gets implemented the way it was intended? And then the third piece, which was around the bullet point of affect the smallest number of students possible, they said long-term, yes, because that's in alignment with one of their outcomes, which is strong and stable enrollment in all schools, but for now, no. That should not be the focus. It's get the enrollment right to the best extent possible and make the necessary changes you have to. So short-term, no. Long-term, ideally.
Pamela, you've got 52,000 things over here, so.
So as you all know, there were several things that don't appear to be completely related. So, but there is some similarity with what was said by the other two groups. So we discussed assigned neighborhood school based on address, and in this venue, there was this big discussion around proximity. It wasn't don't assign by address, but that proximity needs to be a big driver, so I think that that's aligned with things we've heard other places, and aligned with our values of equity, and then also just how it would affect the value of having an environment that supports the learning, so that we make sure that the neighborhood is defined so that we have healthy schools, environmentally healthy and appropriate. We went really down a level, and here we talked about things like, in this section they say characteristics by grade level, ethnicity, gender. There's places where we spell things out very specifically, and either we need to be expansive in our list, or we just need to say demographics. Pick a level and be all inclusive. We talked a little bit back here around if we're talking about location and proximity, that this needs to apply to SPED, ESL, and all the ed as well. And so that it's, yes, it's about the neighborhood school, but how does policy say that this is true for all programs? That we use an equity lens, we look at locations. And it also has to be called out to apply to immersion schools and focus option schools, so that all of these things don't only apply to a neighborhood school, they apply to all schools. Changing the number of transfers, we just might need to refer to the SACIT policy changes. This may need to be amended purely because there have been changes since that policy was made. Again, we talked about there's only boundary change is only one lever, so there's a lot of levers listed here. How do we know which one is being applied? And then, in various forms, how do we avoid a crisis by can we put into policy a trigger for action? So in the project ideas or examples of that might be something like if enrollment targets are projected to be exceeded by X percent over Y number of years, a process would begin. So trying to get, I think the consensus was there's a lot of language about monitoring data and looking at data, but what precipitates action and what action is precipitated feels very vague. An analysis of school boundary factors, again, words about clarity, transparency, and alignment with the D-BRAC values, so sort of the level of specificity that they are aligned with these specific values that we identified. And this was the recommendations would be put, this is about the superintendent's recommendations and how she makes recommendations to the board. And just the analysis needs to be spelled out a little bit more. Incorporating input. So there was a fair amount of discussion by all groups about this is a great place to insert the racial equity lens and the racial equity policy, the idea of culturally specific outreach to codify a little bit of what SACET and D-BRAC have done in terms of their outreach and pull some of that into policy, because this really says we send out some emails, we meet once, it's very, very specific language, and we may want to evolve what that language, or we want to evolve what that language is. We discussed, this section is all about the speed with which changes are made, and somewhat mimicking what Jason just said. There was a conversation around moving faster gives voice to Title I and underrepresented minorities, and that's what the survey seems to indicate. That would align with our racial equity value, and that there's this idea that kids are resilient, that by definition you're probably moving pretty many kids at once, and so that it's not like you're moving one kid or five kids. And then there was also a discussion about the need for feeder patterns for immersion schools. So there was some lack of clarity about how this applies to immersion, focus option, alt ed, other special ed, et cetera, ELL schools, so we need to need some clarity around that. We didn't get to a lot of language just because of the breadth of what we were trying to cover.
I thought that our assignment was to go home and write questions and stuff like that to this, yes? Mm-hmm. But I don't feel like some of the questions and recommendations that were written by the committee, is that going to be talked about? Or?
So the next 20 minutes is a large group discussion. And part of what we need to focus on are the areas where variability has surfaced, right? The areas where there's a lot of agreement among the committee, we don't need to spend our limited time rehashing those. So what we need to figure out and talk about is places where there's variability, so the subcommittee has some guidance about how to get the next iteration, the next draft in front of this group. So the So Pamela, Jason, and Joe, are based on what you've heard, and maybe Judy weigh in on this a little bit. Is there a topic that the three of you would like to hear first on, or talk a little bit about first, Pamela?
Sorry, I don't want to answer. Can I just answer? Respond.
Sure.
So I think if there's homework that people did, because I know people did come in, they have written, they should give them to us, because this is at this point sort of an additive process, so that we can keep identifying areas of alignment and areas. So if there's any work that's done, please give to me.
Well, in my comments fed in, I was more thinking about the comments that you guys had written when they were given to us, like the looking at maybe this would be appropriate to use Brooks. Mm-hmm. What is that called? Probability-based. Mm-hmm. One request I have is, can we see that modeled? I don't know what that looks like, and so
this question that fits into this section. And what I was going to ask is if there were things that if you did the homework and you came prepared to talk about something and you didn't see it listed here, if we take 1 minute to get that up. So if you didn't see that discussed here, which is essentially in the assigned by address.
I'm questioning, I'd like to, and I that was a question, is that even a possibility? Can we take that?
Okay.
Can we take
it? So you want to make sure that, okay. So let's just make sure, let's just see if there's other things, and then let's go through and get to that.
Okay.
Along with any other big points that, and I know that Scott put on the table, what about prioritization? So is this the time that we take that on, or is there an interim step before we get to that? So that's what we're hoping to do. We have few more minutes. So is there any other issues that came up for people when they were there doing their homework or at the tables that you didn't hear expressed here that you thought were like kind of showstoppers and you want to make sure there's a few more minutes on it?
Yes.
While you're answering, I'm going to describe what you just asked about.
So I think this is, actually, Margaret. So I think this is what Judy is asking, because I also thought I heard at our first table the whole idea of demographics, and the statement currently says that schools reflect the demographics of the entire district. Mm-hmm. And I think we had called out that what we really are after is demographics of the community or neighborhood or however it is.
Yes.
Whatever terms we
use. Yes.
Okay, Margaret,
right, yeah.
And then Jill.
So there, I just have two, I guess one's a question that came up after listening to, being at Madison and listening to the families and trying to work through this survey with that evening and having some concerns about the language in the survey and how that was interpreted in people's responses. Mm-hmm. So I don't know what to do with that information other than it seemed somewhat inaccessible to some of the folks that night, inaccessible isn't the right word.
But one interpreter said there was a lot of acting out of the questions necessary for people to understand what was being asked.
So in the translations, there was a concern about sort of how if things have been, the simplest way to say it is if things have been lost in translation literally, and then also how people interpret different things. And so there was some, how did you get to the understanding? They did talk about acting things out. So then the next question I have is, as we're reading through these pieces, it's a clarifying question perhaps about, so is the boundary framework decisions, do they begin at what level are we saying that they begin at? Are we saying that this really, that the policies are really at a district when we're reviewing it at a district level? Or is it these pieces where we're looking there? Where are we starting at? Are we starting at the district level and working to a site, or are we starting at a site and building out? Mm-hmm. And the order is significant, I think. Mm-hmm. I think it changes. But it's written, as I'm hearing these, it's written from a site out, is how I'm hearing them, but I don't know if other people feel the same way.
So site out versus district in.
Yes.
Down.
Can you talk a little bit more about that, be a little more concrete, and how you see the difference being important? Because I got a little bit of what you're saying, but I'm not.
And I think it started on the poster over there, where there was this question about and I think the language was what triggers, or what would cause a district boundary decision, or a boundary decision to start happening, or a review. Right, what would cause a review?
Right.
And the piece is about over and under enrollment, and you only talk about over and under enrollment as we have talked about it at a site, and then say the site has an issue, so what are we gonna do about this site? And then it only grows to the surrounding sites based on the problem at a localized position, as opposed to saying here's a cluster or a group of schools that we're seeing, or the district overall or a grade level that we're seeing an issue.
So
and so if you start at a site, then you're talking about corner points to neighboring sites to begin with, as opposed to saying, here's the issue we're seeing in K-5s, and what are all the places that we can work in? So you either, anyway, that's.
So what's your answer?
It reads
site
to
up
me,
or district down?
It reads to me as if the policies and the directives are starting at a site and building up. That's how it reads to me.
Is that the way it should be?
Is that how other people are reading it, and is that, and how significant, I guess, has
so,
it ever heard?
Two things. I think it is from the site out. I don't know if that's right or wrong, but that's the way it's written now, and it's, you know, there's something terribly practical or given the way the policy's written now, too. It's like, get the most out of what you got site-wise and build that out and try to be as equitable as you can in doing that and predictable. I mean, That's kind of the principle. And then the second thing, though, is a different topic. But I wanted to go back to, I think, the one that we were talking about before, which is, well, it's up there, diverse demographics. As a group, I think we need to go back and have a little discussion of that, because I guess I agree with a number of folks who've talked about it. It's unclear what people mean by that. And it's even unclear in the survey. And I'm not, you know, it's a high priority. It was like number two, right? But I'm not sure people are hearing it or thinking about it in the same ways. And I don't know how to discover that. So I just think we need to reason it through.
I think the one response I would offer to Margaret is, when I think back to, I wasn't part of the process, I could be getting wrong, but when the district was engaged in the Jefferson cluster enrollment balancing process, my interpretation of it was, when that think group hit a point when they realized we're again looking at it as just within a subset of schools, that community stepped back and said, this is what has been happening for years. You do it in silos. It's not healthy and it's not sustainable. And so therefore they said, through the resolution in 2013, said, step back, do a district-wide effort, which is where that pivot was. And so I think, to Margaret's point, is, yeah, I agree, policies have been very much look at it by a case-by-case basis, and therefore you don't know which tool to use. But I think the district is moving to this point where we know we have to do district-wide, and I think that's come up through the points of, if you're going to do it right, figure out what the appropriate lever is, but you have to look at it from a district-wide focus, particularly in the fact that we're growing. So you've got to be more holistic about it. At least that's my sentiment from 2 years ago.
So Tim and then Hector.
It hadn't even occurred to me, but you're right, and it totally made me think of Jefferson and decisions being made in a vacuum. But the other thing that I don't feel like has been talked about, and it comes to the stable feeder pattern, and we talked about it last week, and we said that we were going to talk about a resolution today, is codify it, that high schools, I still don't see how we can make a decision about a K-5, 6-8 without talking about feeder patterns all the way through, programmatically, and just gen ed. We need to make a statement on that.
So let me respond to the second part first. I believe I've heard that high school boundaries are on the table. So I personally don't need any more reassurance about that. I think we have said that in several different ways, several different times. In terms of Margaret's question, I think stuff is going to happen, and it's either going to be a capacity issue or a program issue or something else that's going to generate the question, what do we need to do about it? What's the correct lever to pull about it? And then, so I can only speak for the boundary part, it then goes through the process that we have set up. And that we are creating a body called SACET/D-BRAC, which may come up with its own thing, that's going to have an opportunity to review all of
racket.
Or racket.
Sack.
Ooh. Sacra. So anyway, so I think we're going to have...
Sorry. 15 minutes, we can do it.
So I think we're going to have a built-in mechanism to address, is the district pulling the right lever? And if so, and I totally, so where it comes from might be a question. I think what we're all saying is, but the solution needs to be systemic.
So Sheila, then Michelle.
I had taken my hand down, but I just wanted to point out that there was a point at which we were trying to decide at the far wall, at what point are they triggered?
Mm-hmm.
And so if we want to take a district-wide point of view, it could start at at what point our boundary review, a district-wide boundary review triggered. And we could use district-wide issues to trigger that boundary review.
Like, you give me an example.
Okay, we're forecasting growth of 5,000 new students within. That seems like a good trigger. But maybe those aren't the right numbers. Maybe, you know, like there's a forecast of X percentage of growth within the next Y, you know, years, or uneven growth in the city could be another example. Like, we're seeing building permits, or it's anticipated that there is going to be very uneven growth within our cluster, between our clusters, and that we expect that that's going to cause some capacity issues within the existing system. That could be a district-wide way of looking at it.
So, Michelle, Joe, Scott, you have about 5 minutes left.
Okay, I'll try and be fast. To just piggyback on what she said, or to give you another example, or you have, now we have 50% of our schools that are under or over-enrolled. Say you start when there's 20% of our schools are under-enrolled, something that would show the movement of students around. But that's not what I was saying. What I wanted to say was, I'm thinking about the long term, and I'm not seeing a lot of mechanisms like how we do stuff in there, and I'm thinking about two things, opening new schools and creating the middle schools or changing the grade configurations, and how does that, so this is, I don't think, on there, and maybe it's not part of the policy, but how does that, are there other policies about school openings that we need? There is, I've never read that. The policy
it's
is up there?
One of the levers
there.
That
yeah,
you
it's
can
all, there's
use
a list of levers over there.
But what? How does that, should we merge it in to, I think it would make sense to merge it into the same document, because that mm-hmm. is a district-wide perspective that over time you may open and close, and that's all part of the boundaries mm-hmm. and that they should be integrated as well as the grade configuration policy if there is one.
Joe, and then Scott. Looks like
yeah,
you're reading
I just I don't want this section that was over there that I didn't get to participate in because I was over here seems to be a lot of where the action is for these system questions. And so that's why I was sitting here thinking we haven't talked about how long a period of stability we're shooting for. Which would say how far out to the future do you want to look and how far back do you got to step? And then the things like this, what triggers a system-wide look, what triggers the other tools? And so that's part of what, I just need to go back and look
yeah,
at that stuff.
So maybe
Scott and then Maxie, and then Mike.
So Margaret's point, I think, is really, really good. Because I want to agree, I think these policies are written, and the trigger discussion is sort of gets at that same thing of, hey, everything's fine, except, oh, we've got a problem over there, right? As opposed to saying, we're going to have a regular review of boundaries to talk about not only, I think having triggers is important, but also all the other stuff that is going on future, to look at all that. And the purpose of the trigger points is to say, we have to do something. It doesn't necessarily mean we have to fix in here and do like that. It might be broader than that. But that's at a minimum, we've got a systems issue that we need to address. Second, I want to take a stab at prioritization of these six factors that we've got right now, which are not numbered. The one that says stable program and enrollment in surrounding schools, that enrollment in surrounding schools, that's all language of we're going to fix this problem here and look and see how it affects the schools next to it. And I think we kind of want to maybe think about striking that kind of language and saying, hey, we're going to we're going to monitor boundaries to ensure stability of at least 6 years. And I say 6 years because if we have a K6 or a K5, that's 6 years. And ideally, in the future, when we stabilize the system, I think any boundary changes should start with a new kindergarten class so that kids aren't moved. That's where we want us to get to. We're not going to get to probably at this time, but that's, I think, where we want to be in the future. So I would say that's how we do things regardless. So that's sort of a, not a priority among six, but it's sort of overarching. And I would say the number one would be optimal use of buildings. Number two would be stable feeder pattern. And I'm going to say diverse student body and compact boundaries are tied to three. And the limited impact on students is the fifth one. And that'll get a conversation started. And I reserve the right to change my mind.
Maxine.
I'm going to go first because I just want to ask a question.
I just want to add a comment on the trigger point. As we've kind of said, the trigger point for boundary review is when a school is over or under enrolled. And I guess I just put the table on the question, are there other trigger points such as all the schools have the right number of kids, but the superintendent determines that we're not meeting our goals in terms of equity from a racial point of view, from a socioeconomic point of view, or from any other point of view, right? So you could have the right number of kids. I'm raising the question of whether over and under enrollment is the only trigger to relook at boundaries.
So in my mind, what we're saying is no.
Right.
It's one of the triggers. It's one of the things that would make you consider it, but the things that you mentioned and things that we're not even thinking of might trigger a question about do we need to do better.
Okay, but everything I heard was other examples of how you got over or under enrolled, and I'm saying you could have the right number of kids for the size of buildings.
But if I could, I heard several times concern or ideas about programs such as the DLI expansion and things like that that also have a strong impact on enrollment, and that those are factors that necessitate change as well.
Maxine, can we wait on the question?
Yeah.
It looks like Jason wants to wait on that on this topic.
This is why I'm glad you all are talking about this, because about a month ago, over Memorial Day weekend, I created what was a draft of a four-pronged litmus test to actually help long-term for the district to assess enrollment conditions. So I just wanted to read through as a starting point I'll share with everyone. So these are what I thought were like the four things that would help the district assess potentially the different ways you address enrollment. So one was current and future student enrollment and demographics. Part of that question factors in whether the enrollment projections for that attendance boundary over the next 5 years, of the number of students that are currently attending this school, how many reside in the attendance boundary, how many reside outside the school's attendance boundary, and under what conditions? Are they going because of a program through the lottery, like transfer or an immersion program, or are they accessing a district-wide program, immersion or special education or something? So getting a clear sense of who's in that building attending it and based on what condition. So understanding the demographics. Prong two, which was facility utilization. So getting a sense of how the facility is being used now, programmatic needs, et cetera. Third is, and I think this gets to a point where Kim was talking about, which is what I call the prong around previous actions. To what extent has the school experienced a change due to the district's implement a different enrollment balancing lever over the last 5 years? So it's basically calling out as a question, how many times has a community gone through some kind of enrollment balancing change? So calling it out. And then the fourth being surrounding conditions. What factors are creating conditions for potential over or under enrollment outside the district's control? Housing development, if so, what kind? Single family, multiple housing units, existence or placement of additional education options, like movement of a focus option school, which from enrollment data we now has a huge pull on neighborhood enrollment demographics, siting of new immersion programs, and the potential existence of current and future charter schools, because we know those have an impact on enrollment. So I would just offer that as a starting point. I'm happy to send this out as a way to say long term, here's something in place that I would throw out for consideration.
Thank you.
So you'll share that with the group?
Yep.
Excellent. Thank you for being patient.
No. I haven't been able to wrap my brain around this. Somebody told me that 45% of the students in PPS were minority students, right? And then when I look at the city as a whole, the city of Portland, we have, what, a 13 or 14% minority population at best?
It's bigger than that.
No, it's bigger than that.
What is it?
It's in the 20s. It's going to be 30.
The
45%. The
45%
is
actually. So half of that is, say, minority, is 20% minority population in the city. So how do we get to the point where we have these segregated school areas and the disparities that exist in the school around education and equality and all that, with just that, with this that small population, how do we get there? That's my question. How do we unconsciously or consciously concentrate minority students, you know, in one area, minority people in one area, and yet and still they're just a small nucleus of the larger population. And and we talked about, you know, a number of the kids going to private schools. So how do you draw a boundary when you don't know, you know, what part of that, you know, what families in that school district may go to private schools and may not even attend PPS?
I want to help answer your question, and I'm just not sure that right at 8
that's
11.
Okay. That's okay.
How about 8:16? Let's talk and see if I can get
okay.
some of that. I think the short answer is a whole lot of history of segregation and school boundaries that enforce it.
The only time we get information about.
I don't know if they can argue.
So, what before we transition, John wants to share some information with us. Before we transition to that, I want to get a quick head nod from Pamela and Jason and Joe. Are you guys?
Can you give them 1 minute to maybe just off the top of your head what you guys see for next steps? I mean, clearly a lot of this is come from the committee and on to you. Anything that you want to share back with the whole committee towards next steps or what they should be prepared for to support this before the next meeting on the 25th? Anything, Joe's got something.
Well, just, Judy, could you just run through the major milestones we face now? When do we meet with Carol? When do we have to report out to the school board? That's in July.
Okay. Yes, so we were looking at sort of a soft deadline of June 30th to submit to the superintendent. Your next D-BRAC meeting is June 25th, and so that might be the first time that you see a full draft of the framework based on what has happened so far. It may still have enough holes in it and places that need serious work that you may then need another iteration of review so that your final pass off to the superintendent wouldn't be until after 4th of July. The date with the board, John, I'm correct, has not yet been scheduled.
Is tentatively scheduled for July 7th.
And July 7th, okay.
I expect that to stick.
July 7th, that's
you expect
good
it to stick?
Yes, I expect that to stick, but it's tentative.
Okay, and given holidays and the like, July 7th, there's not a whole lot of daylight between June 25th and July 7th. So, there you go.
Well, so, it'd be great if we got folks a next draft before the 25th, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And if we got it to you, like how far ahead of the 25th, the 25th is a Thursday, mm-hmm. is it useful, you know? Because the more time we have, the better it's going to be for us, but how much time do you want to spend thinking about it? Because it'd be great to come into the next meeting having consumed it like many of you did this thing here, but mm-hmm. what we're trying to do now is head towards a draft that can be the foundation of a report, right? And I can imagine us getting a certain ways down the road on re-engineering based on what we heard tonight, but I also can imagine there's just a lot of questions, and that's the best we're going to be able to do, report back to the superintendent. And so if that was our goal for the 25th, to have the beginnings of, have a draft of a report that looks like that, you know, how much, if we got it to you at the end of the day Monday and you had 2 days to look at it, does that work for folks?
So put your hand up if it would work for you to get a draft of the report at the end of the day, Monday, June 22nd.
And you could give your have your feedback ready by the 25th.
Would that give you enough time for feedback on the 25th? Hands up. I see like 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11.
I don't know how long it is. Like, what?
It's our draft. It's our draft of our report out to the superintendent.
Like full recommendations, complete framework, policy.
As best as the subcommittee can get done by then on your behalf.
Yeah, and I don't know how far based on, you know, we've got today, but we can. So we just need to try to give it a run and see what it comes up with.
So, our half-hearted hand raises, I think that could work for the group.
Maybe I missed something. Are we saying that based on what we've done today, the subcommittee is going to write our recommendations, draft our recommendations?
First draft.
I don't think it's fair to say we're going to draft our recommendations. I think, but we have this deadline. So I think it would be more fair to say that we could draft a report to the superintendent. That sort of says how we'll
where handle we are.
Yeah, I think just listening to the feedback, I just want to propose that maybe we codify what, you know, certain things that we've been talking about a lot. So this is the context, this is the values. And then with this, we say these are areas that we find we are focusing on review, or these are questions that we have around policy or things like that. I don't think we're going to get to, I don't feel at this moment where I feel like in any way I could revise policy based on this input without really bringing it back.
Right.
Yeah.
So if it can be a list of.
And you know, one of the best examples of that is this discussion we were just having on system-wide versus building triggers versus what do you look at, and how long a period in the future you're shooting for stability in these kind of regards. Our best shot back to the superintendent is to say, here's the questions that we think system-wide, and you know, here's what we're grappling with. If it's system-wide, it's this bigger look, and we know that you've got attendance problems on any given year to solve. Those are two different scales of decision. And it sounds like we aren't going to be satisfied with a recommendation that just tackles the individual school problem year to year, right? That's sort of what I heard tonight. So we got a ways to go to frame the other one, but I don't know how far till we step back and look at what we've done so far.
Kim, one thing that has struck me is as this group's gone forward the last few weeks, the questions. You're very focused on the questions that are emerging and where you see you want to go next. And I wonder if you're kind of forgetting how much you've already agreed on. And you're largely, 3 months ago, you had a bunch of questions back here that you've answered, and now you're to this set, and now you're to that set. So you've come farther than you may feel like you have right now. Kim? We're 4 minutes over, I observed that, and John still needs to give us some information about what the future looks like. So, yeah.
I am probably alone in this, although I think Michelle and I are kind of on the same page on this. I don't feel like there's enough time and all that getting something, you know, to look at on the 25th and then turn around on the 7th. I personally would, and this is assuming you guys could turn around with something. What? I personally think we should have a meeting next week to look at where you guys are at and then be that much closer to a final by the 25th.
Can we just get a quick show on who would be available for a meeting next week? I would say Thursday, your normal day. From what people know right now, about half of the room.
Joe's checking his calendar.
You know, it just, it's
so the risk for a meeting next Thursday is the subcommittee won't have enough time to write enough and pull together enough that it would be far enough step ahead.
Right.
So this is me, the facilitator, trying to protect our subcommittee members who have been meeting a lot and writing a lot. And
the board
this is... So everyone's had a chance to look at their calendar, and the three subcommittee members didn't revolt, so let's do...
Okay, but that's different, because it's a different board. You can't use those dates. They're not equal.
So our ultimate deadline is January, and if changes are going to be made in the fall, the board has to meet in and vote in January. And you start backing up, that means that for... our ideas to get turned into math, that has to be done over the summer. So from my point of view, I'm nervous about letting too much slide too far. So I want to do another, thank you, almost. So I want to do another show of hands next Thursday night for a D-BRAC meeting, regular time and place, who is available.
Okay, but back to your original question, can the subcommittee get that done? Because I said that. I don't know.
I opposed it, and nobody vomited.
Oh, you know,
nobody said
it. If you were to ask me, I'd love to have 2 weeks, but it may not be realistic. I hear what you're saying. So at this point of these projects, it's great to have a little time to get the work done, because the product that we can turn back to you could be more thoughtfully built, you know, like we're doing the best we can, but a little bit like we're running from a framework we inherited, or not that it's bad, but some of the questions everybody's put on the table tonight would make us like want to rethink that to a certain level, but I'm not going to aspire to rethink it too much because we don't have time. Well, our objective, this is just me speaking, but I would take my assignment to be to help communicate to the superintendent in the most useful way, sort of where we are, you know, right? It's sort of, because that's the best, if anything else would be probably not legitimate, representative as a recommendation, because I don't get the sense that we're there yet, but telling the superintendent where we are allows these judgments to be exercised that this is taking too long and they still need to go forward, so they're going to have to rescope how we do it, or we need to give D-BRAC some more time, or we need to give D-BRAC something. See what I'm saying? Like, there's a decision point here for the superintendent, but we only can report out what we've done. And I'd like to give you all back the best thinking we could on it. We could come back next week. It's just,
it's a tall order.
It's a quick turnaround, but Pamela's.
So, closer to Pamela.
To me!
Pamela, right, so a lot Scott.
Of committee members have.
No, please. I'll. It's okay.
So, what I don't have, I've got a fuzzy sense of, but I don't have something in writing, is sort of a hey, here's where we do have consensus. Here are the things still on the table to get us to, and here's what. Here are the content areas that need to be in our final recommendation. And I think you guys have pieces of that, but I don't have it like.
Right, because that is exactly what we would distill out. To me, this information tonight is the first step of where we actually begin to know the answer to that. And so we don't have it because we need some time. Some
number of days to take these notes, distill them, and feed them back to you. And then you need some time to absorb them and feed them back to us. So, yes. And the question is, how fast does feedback? But the other piece in that is, in terms of timeline, what are the essential things that we need so that Sean can start working?
Yeah.
And what are the things like the big picture thing about, are we doing individual school or top, that's longer term framework that
we don't need right away for Sean to start working. And so if there's, I think we can do some kind of prioritization along that. And, you know, the report to the board on the 7th, if that's the timeline, might be, hey, here's where we are, here's what we still need to explore, but at least we can get working. Or it might be, we need another 2 weeks.
So actually what Scott said towards the end is what I wanted to clarify. We're talking about meeting with the superintendent to share where we're at. The meeting with the board is us telling the board where we're at. Is that correct? It's not Carol making her recommendations yet.
That's correct.
And so the board is going to say, oh, well, that's nice, but here's what we think about it. And then Carol will use us and what the board says to make her final recommendation. Okay. So that's my understanding of what the process moving forward is. We don't need to give Carol, here's what we want you to recommend to the board. There are still at least two steps in there before she has to do that. Is that?
Can I respond to that?
Yeah, John.
So yeah, I mean, that what Joe said and what Scott said and now we're here is exactly right. When you meet with Carol, you'll say, here's where we're at, and you'll get feedback from her, and it'll get more specific. It'll say, here's where I want you to really hone in on. You do the same thing with the board, which will be the new board, and you'll get their reaction, same thing. That will be followed up with more specific feedback from the superintendent. And then that should help you do the narrowing you need to get your recommendation done. Okay? So, sorry if that was not clear. It isn't to have your final thing done, here you go, we're done on July 7th. It's to do exactly what you just described.
Okay. So I've got several hands. It's 8:27. John still needs to talk a little bit about this piece of paper.
Minute.
This is what?
This is 1 minute.
All right, so John still needs to have a 1 minute thing.
I was just going by the timeline, which says that I was under the impression we were to deliver a framework, a complete framework, and recommendations before summer. When is that due? The complete of the formal set of recommendations?
Yeah.
Are we ever doing that? Or
so, no? I guess what I would say to you
is
I understand why you're asking, but I also don't want to build in any false sense of deadlines right now. What you heard is a couple big things coming up. The superintendent is available to hear where you are on June 25th. On your behalf, we ask that she not come tonight because you are still working, but she's planning on coming in 2 weeks. After that, you have some time scheduled with the school board. Exactly what you present to them will be a matter of what you create by then. And you, I think, have a sense of what the maximum scope of that could be. And if you don't hit the maximum scope, this is not a deficit game where if you don't hit it, you're fired, right?
That's what you were hoping for.
You have to suspend some of those needs for absolute dates at this moment, as we are.
I just want a month or 2 month range.
You
I'm
have what's
saying.
In front of you, and we're still really close to that. So if you add a month or two, you'll have what you need.
If you look at the timeline, and we can go back to it, and we're right in the window still. The original timeline I reviewed here with you. I mean, it's a target. It's not exact date, and we've had some dynamics come into it. You know, when we started this, we didn't know there was going to be 40 board members, things like that. So, but I still personally feel like we're fine on time.
And we're
so,
not meeting
in
the summer.
Yes, I would expect that we're going to poll to see availability through the summer if it's needed.
Joe,
so just to backtrack on what I said before. It might be useful to pick up for us to come back next week with what we can get done, and to maybe frame up some of these bigger questions so that we can have some discussion of those as a group, because our next product is some report to Carol, and so you know, rather than leap in and try to, I'm worried about the amount of time, but leap in and try to structure it, but we can come back at the outline level and say, here's, you know, here's what something might look like, and here's those kind of big questions, like Scott, you were raising, and how they might fit into what we're doing in a report to Karen, or the superintendent.
I just want to say, I personally don't want to rush you guys. I don't want you to feel incredible pressure that you have to produce something in 4 days, kind of a thing. So, you know, that's, I want good product. What can I do to support you?
So we're at 8:30. We're 15 minutes over. I'm going to call the question again. Put your hand up if you want to meet next Thursday night.
Well, I think what I've heard also is that they would like the subcommittee to make the call on that. And subcommittee, I don't know that you need to do that immediately, but could we agree that you will be notified by Thursday on a meeting next Thursday? So tentatively, hold it right. So today's Tuesday. You will know in 2 days. You will hear in 2 days if there is a call for a meeting next week, or whether you should expect just to receive something electronically, and you'll get to spend your 2.5 hours in your own private place doing your review.
So the last 1 minute to John to explain the sheet of paper that he handed out.
Yeah, what you have is a draft. Okay, this is a draft. I don't want any feedback on it right now because we could be done. What I would like is for members to review this. This is us getting ready to have the communication materials we know we're going to need when it's time for you to go to the board. So we would like your feedback. Just email to me, especially on the process, if it works for you or if you think there's things we can clarify to improve. Process. What you have is the current process you're in on top and the future process on the bottom. Okay? And then the frequently asked questions, if you have anything you think we should add, if there's a question you're getting that you want us to add or you think the answer can be improved, send it to me. We already had someone identify a typo. But that's what this is. We want to give you guys a chance to.
Can we get this electronically?
Yes, I'll email to you.
Great.
Thank you.
Could you please take a minute and salute your subcommittee for the fine work that they're doing?
We are adjourned.